author, activist, and the founder of the Fortune Society. He was inspired to start the Fortune Society after producing a play called Fortune in Men's Eyes, which revealed the horrors of life in prison. Over the past 50 years, Fortune has become one of the nation's leading reentry service organizations, serving nearly 7,000 individuals annually with a wide range of holistic services to meet their needs. It has secured a position as a leading advocate in the fight for criminal justice reform and alternatives to incarceration. David has touched the lives of countless numbers of people and is beloved by the Fortune community and way beyond. Before his semi-retirement, his show airs only on the first Saturday of the month now from 8 to 10 on BAI. I was glued to the radio every Saturday morning from 8 to 10 to hear David's show any Saturday. I had come to depend on David's wisdom as he talked about the current state of affairs in politics, the world, and my community. I was inspired to volunteer at the Fortune Society, which was one of the greatest things I have ever done. He also shared his thoughts on shows, movies, and books that were worthwhile. It's a wonder to imagine how this man gets to the theater, the movies, books, and the gym every week and still has time to give of himself at the Fortune Society, but he does. In the last volume of the Fortune News, a publication put out by the Fortune Society, there was a beautiful article written by Casimiro Torres, the superintendent of the Fortune Society. Casimiro has been at the Fortune Society for the last 13 years, and he gives credit to David for being like a father figure to him. More than that, he calls David his father. Casimiro's words describe the deep impact that David has had not only on Cas, but on countless others throughout the years. Casimiro writes, "My father is not tall like me, nor do I have his eyes. My father is a little old Jewish man who wears glasses and funny shirts. My father has taught me many things. He taught me that I am not the worst thing that I have ever done. He has told me that I am a good man, a kind man, and even noble at times. I am just like my father." Please join me in welcoming David Rothenberg.
Thank you, Barbara. I've been familiar with the rigid catechism of the ethical culture for many years. I was introduced in 1953. I was a college student, and I got a scholarship to the Encampment for Citizenship, which was at Fieldston. And I share this story because what happened at Fieldston that summer had an enormous impact on my life. The Algernon Black and Nannie Politzer, so, the name resonate with any? If it doesn't, you're under 50, if it does. They were two incredibly human beings who had great foresight, and they created this summer program. I came in as a student from the University of Denver, and their mission was to bring in people who had kids who had very different backgrounds. So there were farm kids from Montana, Native Americans off the reservation, black and white kids from South Carolina, Mississippi, and Louisiana, Puerto Rican and Dominican kids from New York and Chicago, an incredible mix. And their thesis was that if you bring people who are very diverse into an ideal situation, that the differences fade away as you have a shared mission. And that's exactly what happens at the encampment, which continues in various parts of the country to this day. Where is it now? This summer, I think it's gonna be, it was in Mississippi and then it was in Boston. Albuquerque? Well, I might get to that one. But it was extraordinary, and we had great speakers that came in. We spent a day with Mrs. Roosevelt at Hyde Park, and we had people from the stock market and from labor unions. And then we would have discussions afterwards. But what we were constantly told is that you have a voice and you have to use it. And if you recognize injustices or things that are not fair, if everyone is silent around you, you have the voice and you have an obligation to use it. And that's what I got from the encampment. And over the years, when I've spoken at different places, invariably someone comes up to me and says, I was at the encampment of 72 or 68. And we have that shared bond of knowing that this ethical culture inspired program has a lasting impact. So I thank the ethical culture for giving me that at a very a crucial point in my formulation. So I was in college, and after the encampment, when I went back to college, I did a couple of things. I participated at one of the early sit-ins in the 50s in Washington at the People's Drug Store before the Civil Rights Movement began. Was a spy for the Anti-Defamation League, going into churches that were racist and anti-Semitic, and we only had a 6-month stay as a spy because they discovered who you were. But those are some of the things that I did after the encampment. After college, Army, came to New York, wanted to work in the theater, took many jobs before I finally was hired in the summer of 59. There's history, isn't it? Ancient history. The summer of 59, I was hired for the summer to work in a publicity office, and I knew this is the arena in which I wanted to work, and I was very good at it, and I just propelled myself. Within 3 or 4 years, I was working in different press offices, working with the biggest stars in the theater, Bette Davis and Julie Harris and the like. And then I was hired by Alexander Cohn, who was one of the most prominent and successful producers, to handle all of his shows, and worked with Beyond the Fringe and Maurice Chevalier and Charles Boyer, et cetera, et cetera. And the big change came, for those of you who know your theater history, in the summer, in 62, Richard Burton and Elizabeth Taylor discovered each other on the set of Cleopatra. Those who are in a blank look are under 50. Those who, it was an international scandal. Richard was married to Sybil Burton. Elizabeth, for some inexplicable reason, was married to Eddie Fisher. And on the set of Cleopatra, they discovered each other. And this was pre-cable television, and it was an international scandal because they left there, understandably. Well, he left Sybil, she understandably left Eddie. And they went to Puerto Vallarta, he was making Night of the Iguana, at which point Alexander Cohn said to me, we're doing Hamlet, Richard starring, John Gielgud's directing, and you handle the media. And it was decided to rehearse in Toronto because of the feeling was that the paparazzi would be overwhelming in New York. When I arrived in Toronto in December of 63 to begin rehearsals, the hotel where I and Richard and Elizabeth were staying was picketed by about 250 people from the Legion of Decency because, I don't know if this is a word that they know at ethical culture, it was considered a shanda if someone laughed, it nudged them, they'll explain the word. A shanda is a shame, and that Richard and Elizabeth were living together outside of marriage in sin. And that's what I was dealing with. And with the media that was, I'll just tell you how bad it was. When the show opened in Toronto, then went to Boston, I was at the airport to greet them. I had all the information for the chartered plane, where the cast was to go and what hotels. And 10,000 people preceded me at Logan Airport to celebrate the arrival of the scandalous couple. And I was 27 or 28 at the time, looking 12, arriving with my suitcase of information about where everyone would go, and the cops wouldn't let me through the line, and I tried to get through, and I was knocked out, and ended up in the first aid room, where I prove to a nurse that I was indeed the advance man, and they rushed me out to the hangar where the plane was. And that's what it was like working on this Hamlet. It was an enormous success. Every night at the L'Enfantine, thousands of people from the other shows would stand there. The cops were on horseback on both ends to get a glimpse, mainly of Elizabeth, who was extraordinarily beautiful, you may have heard, and was true. And also, curiously, very other-oriented. She was not self-absorbed. She was, when I met her, she wanted to know all about me, what my interests were. She was a she was unlike the image that you would have expected. But opening night in New York, the opening night, the party was at the Rainbow Room, the top of New York somewhere, and I spent the day with the bomb squad from the FBI because of all the threats. It was not the kind of theater that I was hoping to be involved with, and I never blamed Richard and Elizabeth. I always found theater like Raisin in the Sun or Diary of Anne Frank, the kind of I liked a good Neil Simon comedy or a musical like Pajama Game, but the theater that was a mirror of the social things for which I had a passion was what I wanted to work with. And so I told Alex Cohn that this was it for me, and I took a freighter and I went to live in Italy for a few months, and I said, if I'm going to work in the theater, I want to for it to have much more meaning. I wanted things like Raisin in the Sun or Diary of Anne Frank or Death of a Salesman that were mirrors of our society and affected people, allowed them to think about and talk about things. So I opened up my own press office, and I was immediately working on the biggest shows. I was representing at one point a Tennessee Williams play, a Harold Pinter play, and an Edward Albee play. But what happened then, I went to La Mama and saw a workshop of an anti-war musical called The Viet Rock. It was being shaped, and I said, now this is the kind, this was 66, and the Vietnam War was not yet popular to be against the war. It was just, public consciousness was being raised, and I thought, this is the kind of theater that should be done, and produced with my friends Nancy and Jordan Charney, we produced Viet Rock, which had not a bad run, but the New York Times critic thought that it was all right to be against the war, but must these young people be so strident? It's interesting how you can always remember the bad reviews. But at that time, just about the time, it was in 66, that Nathan Cohn, a critic from the Toronto Star, he and I were having lunch, and he said he had read a play by a Canadian that would never get produced in Toronto because it was too subversive. And he thought it was brilliant. And I said, Nathan, I want to read it. You haven't liked anything since Potemkin. And if you like this, I'd be interested. So he got me the script. And I remember I sat up in bed one night and I started to read it. And I read it twice. And I was devastated. I wrote a letter to John Herbert, the playwright. And I said, I felt that I was trapped in a room with four cobras. All I knew about prison was what the movies told me, the old pictures. They were either rioting or escaping. This was about a young boy in a juvenile facility coming in raped on his first night. I was startled. It was stark theater, but it was also told me something about which I was ignorant. And I said, it had such a truth to it. I went to Canada and I met John, and it indeed was his story. He was the 16-year-old kid who had been gang raped on his first night in prison. He did 6 months in a county jail, had been out for 20 years, but he said he still was on the fringes of society because he never was able to get back in. He was so enraged at a society that would allow this to happen and that he was invisible. And I thought this was theater that had to be done, and produced it. And it opened in February of 1967. To wildly mixed reviews. Before it opened, though, the actors wanted, as actors who are so needy, and wanted to visit a prison. And we arranged to go to Rikers Island. That was my first time I ever was inside of a prison or a jail. It was December of 66, while we were in rehearsal. And that visit to Rikers Island was traumatic for me. All we saw were young men. We were in the juvenile facility. We saw young men being herded about. And I said aloud, whatever they're here for, what put them here? What law did they break? What code did they offend us with? How will they be any better by this experience? They're coming out. It seems like an exercise in futility. And I've been on Rikers about 100 times since then, and in jails and prisons all over the country, all over the world. And that initial reaction never has altered. It's an exercise in futility. Whatever people have done that put them there, they never deal with why they're there. They have to learn how to survive in that environment. Anyway, the play opened to wildly diverse reviews, but one critic said, unless you're obsessed by viewing sodomy, there's no reason to see this, which was the best ticket seller we had. Actually, the rape scene took place off stage. But 2 weeks after the play opened, I got a call from a professor at St. John's who said he was bringing a group of students to see the play. Could we have a discussion afterwards with the cast? And that's right up my alley. And two of the actors, Vic Arnold and the stage manager, David Hannigan. David had whispered in my ear at one point that as a juvenile, he had been in an Iowa juvenile facility, and so he had a passion about the play. And the three of us came out on the stage and invited the entire audience to stay with us for the discussion. And that's when one voice made a difference. The people that were there after the play were very complimentary, saying nice things. And then one man challenged the authenticity of the play. And from the back of the house, a man stood up and he said, after the play was challenged, he said, if you watched what happened to us, you wouldn't believe it. At intermission, he said, I had to look around and see that I was not on my tier. And then he talked about being on Rikers Island and Dannemora and the Florida chain gang. And I said to him, whoever you are, come join us on the stage. And Pat McGarry mesmerized the audience for about an hour because he was talking about things that no one knew. There was no voice for the formerly incarcerated. There was no voice for the incarcerated. People who had come out did not talk about it because their jobs, their housing, their neighbors, their relatives didn't know. And they would lose everything if they were making it out here. So afterwards, we went for coffee, and I said to Pat, come back another week. Come back next Tuesday. We'll do this every week. And he said, well, I did white time. You have to get somebody that did black time. And I said, black and white time in the New York prisons? And he said, absolutely. Back in the 60s, that's what it was. And I said, I don't know anyone. Excuse me. He said, I know a guy where I work. And he came back the following week with an African-American man named Clarence Cooper. And the two of them, for the next few weeks, held forth and really informed the audience about what they went through and what prison was like and the struggle it was for them when they came out. Being a good publicist, I called Cy Peck, who was the arts and leisure editor at the Times, and said, do you want a good story? And he sent a reporter down. And the headline a few days later said, the drama continues after the curtain falls. And the following Tuesday night for our weekly sessions, half the audience were men who had done time. And I say men because it was well over a year before women surfaced and had their voices heard. And these guys started coming every Tuesday night, staying after they saw the play. They'd come down late, and I was hanging out with them. We were having coffee afterwards, and I discovered two things. Almost every one of them was in AA, and they had a place to go to by maintaining their sobriety, they were able to stay out of trouble and out of prison. But their rage about the prison experience had not been touched, and this was new for them. And it was a very exciting period that we didn't know where it was going. It was just a group of people discussing something. Remember the 60s when you didn't have to apologize for caring? This was an arena that had not been touched. And I started getting phone calls from people that had been in the audience saying, teacher saying, could you come to my school? Ethical culturists saying, could you come to the Ethical Culture Society? Unitarians. That's when I discovered the difference between Unitarians and ethical culture was Unitarians had Danish with their coffee, and the ethical cultures had bagels. Other than that, the philosophical difference was rather. And we were on the circuit. We were going around, me and a group of guys who had done time, and it was clear that there was a need. And one night at the theater, I said, we're going to start a group. And 16 people gave me $2, and we opened a bank account at Chemical Bank. I like to say fortune lived longer than Chemical Bank, which was swallowed up by Chase, but what hasn't been? And my one-room theater office on 46 and Broadway became a hangout for men who had done time, and we were a speaking group. There was no staff, there was no program. We put out a mimeograph newsletter. Mimeograph, anybody remember? Yeah, with the ink and you churn it out. It's would been replaced by emails and all of the, and whatever digital has come along. And the state of New York banned it in the state prisons, which was curious, which gave us a great credibility among inmates. That fact that our little newsletter, mimeograph sheets of paper just saying where we're speaking, was not allowed in. And so when Attica jumped off, my name was on the list for the outsiders to go in. Some of you remember 1971, September 9th, the riot at Attica, the inmate uprising. And myself and Kenny Jackson and Mel Rivers were in the yard at Attica during the what was called the negotiations. And we were the media center of the universe at that point, because all the media just came upon fortune after the slaughter by the state. I jumped over something. When we got organized, I had called Gene Kennedy at the David Susskind show. It was almost unheard of for somebody who had been incarcerated to go on television, because their visibility would eliminate any future that they had. And four of our guys agreed to go on the Susskind program on a Sunday night in March of 68. And at the end of the program, Susskind had a crawl that said, if you want to contact them, Fortune Society, 1545 Broadway. And the next day when I arrived at my office, you would have thought it was a prison breakout. I was on the sixth floor, and the stairwell was filled from the first floor to the sixth, about 250 guys, all looking for exactly what men and women who come to Fortune today are looking for: jobs, housing, somebody to talk to, how to break the cycle. And two of the men were Kenny Jackson and Mel Rivers, who stuck around and realized that this is what they wanted to do with their lives. And the three of us made a commitment. And within 3 years, we got enough money that three of us went on salary at $100 a week. I was still working on Broadway shows, which was really paying for the rent of the office and the phones, and decided, I'll just share quickly, that one day I had a phone call from a woman whose husband was in prison. Her welfare check hadn't arrived. She had two children, and she didn't know what to do. And I got a call on the other phone from an agent who had four people coming in from Hollywood who wanted to see Hair that Saturday night, a show which I was representing. And I said to the woman with the children on welfare with no money, can I call you back? I have an emergency on the other phone. And I got the tickets, and I don't remember who the stars were, but they got their tickets to Hair. And I looked at the phone, and I said, I have to make choices. Do I want theater or do I want drama? And I continued working on the shows that I had till they faded away, but I wasn't taking new shows. And I realized Fortune is what I wanted to do with my life, and surrounded by Kenny Jackson and Mel Rivers, and then women like Fran O'Leary and Jeanette Spencer came in. And we were people that were committed not only to reaching out to men and women who were coming out of prison, but to educate and inform an audience that had preconceived stereotypes and fears, sometimes rational, mostly irrational. And that's how we evolved. So that today, 51 years later, I'm long retired. Fortune Society has a staff of 200 people on Long Island City in our main offices. We have a school, and we have prepare people for jobs. We have a residence in Harlem, the Castle, the Fortune Academy, where 62 men and women live. Next door is a permanent residence, a 14-story building, where after they're finished with the transitional housing, half the residents are moving in there. It's what I discovered along the way is that I had a voice that I didn't know I had when I went to the encampment when I was 17 or 18 years old, and that the voice could speak out and be heard. And the most effective thing that it could do is to mobilize other people to speak out so that you're not a group of one speaking about the injustices that exist. The prison system is it continues to be an exercise in futility. You probably heard all the rhetoric. It's overwhelmingly people there with drug and alcohol histories, which is rarely dealt with in the prisons. If it is, it's in spite of the system. Mental illness. They keep talking about people going there for mental illness. I think you'd be mentally ill after being in prison. I've sat in cells. I've been in solitary confinement cells. I've seen people who have been locked up for years in solitary. How they don't go mad is beyond my belief that, and then the transition to come out is so difficult for so many people because the world is so different. We have a community meeting every Thursday night at the Castle. And a few weeks ago, one of the men who had gotten his own place said, I thought I was doing it all right. I had read all the books and all the literature about what to do. And he said, I didn't know when I cooked that I needed a dish rack. And he thought it was little and everybody laughed. And I said, the dish racks are very symbolic of so many things that some people didn't know they needed a dish rack and others didn't know how to work a cell phone and others don't know about computers or doors that open quickly or MTA cards. And if you're frustrated and you're not used to all of that, the little things become, as one man said to me, I learned how to jail. I didn't know how to work out here. And so when people get frustrated and feel that they don't belong out here, what they often do is get high to deal with the pressure. And getting high is the step for going back in. So the system doesn't prepare people for coming out. Fortune, is it just a drop in the bucket for the thousands that hit the streets every day, every week in New York City? I worry about the guy who gets frustrated about a dish rack doesn't have a voice to speak about it. As I've said, I retired. And retirement's kind of exciting because you don't get paid and you can do what you want. And I swim every morning and I go to the to Fortune Society about 3 days a week. We have a play that we do called The Castle. Four of the former residents perform it. I directed it and helped with the cast, one of the cast members, Vilma Donovan sitting over there. Retirement can be very exciting, and as I look around the room, I suspect that there's more than two people in the room you can do exciting and creative things, and particularly in the field of criminal justice, where the needs are so enormous. And so I'm blessed by the invitation to come to you and share my story. And does Ethical Culture still do a Q&A? In the great tradition of your religious zeal. So I thank you and I bow to all of you. And if there are questions, do we do that?
Yes.
We do that. I suspect it as much. So I thank you for allowing me to share with you and be happy to answer any of your questions. Yes. Well, there are no other fortunes, but people from other cities and states come and visit us all the time. We tell them what we did, and it really needs local input because every community is different. Right now, for example, in Syracuse, they're building a reentry residence modeled on the Castle. But I have been, and others at Fortune have been around the country. This year I was in Denver meeting with people who are creating a program modeled on us. And we share information, but yes.
Yeah,
So we are emulated.
So, sir, I'm curious how many people you serve and how many people you get every year.
About 7,000 now come through Fortune every year. Usually the next question is, what is your success rate? And my answer is, please define success. We get jobs, we have people in schools, we have people in this room right now who have come through Fortune. When somebody comes in, there are two groups. We have people who come out of penitentiary, and then we have what is called an alternative to incarceration program. We go into the courts, and we have about 300, mostly teenagers, because that's who the judges and the DA will let come to us. Instead of going to jail, to Rikers, or if they can do 6 months to a year with us, successfully, they get probation rather than incarceration. And one of the plans, if you saw Mayor de Blasio's plan this week for gradually closing of Rikers Island, is to increase the alternative to incarceration program with the notion that people get worse in the care of correction rather than better. And so to reach a lot of the young people, they come to places like Fortune or CASES, other programs that give them educational, vocational. We have anger management, drug relapse classes, but mainly that the staff is mostly formerly incarcerated men and women who understand the problems that they're going through. One of the guys who teaches a two-week course about how to prepare for a job interview. Most of the guys that come to us and the women come to us don't have a job history. How do you deal with your record? How do you present yourself at an interview? And the teacher says, the difference between you and me is I got here first. And then we have volunteer, are you part of that group? We have volunteer retired people, business people, who do mock interviews and sit with them one-on-one. And it's very exciting to watch and to be a part of. And I think the volunteers get, it's a volunteer job that gives you great gratification. It also helps to erase the stereotypes that the formerly incarcerated person has for the square world and for the civilians have for people who have done time. So does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay. And the school, we have a lot of graduations. Yes, sir.
Dave, thank you for sharing more of your lifetime stories. I'm interested, when you were growing up as an adolescent in secondary school at Houston, you mentioned about your two-year experience in the encampment. What exactly, in detail, can you share with us that inspired you when you were experiencing the diversity of the people that you came across? And you were a young school, right?
The encampment was for a summer, it wasn't 2 years.
Yeah.
Some of the things I came from, we had a dormitory with guys, and one of my roommates who I got friendly with was on with the son of an Indian chief in New Mexico, and I went and stayed at a reservation for a few days. And they greeted me like a conquering hero because I had been the son's buddy. And to be able to go to a reservation and not as a tourist, but as a guest and being a friend of somebody, it's the kind of world that the encampment opened me up to. My friend Glory Van Scott, who still, I don't know if you know Dr. Glory, who was at the encampment. We were in the same discussion group. They broke us up because we never stopped talking. Our story is we haven't stopped. African-American kid from Chicago. I didn't know any black women or girls at 16 or 17. I came from a white town in New Jersey. And suddenly this young woman who she went and became a dancer and with Katharine Graham and did Broadway musicals. We had so much to talk about that female, male, black, white, Chicago, New Jersey didn't make any difference. I think that's what happened, is that the differences are viewed by people on the outside, but inside that we saw each other. That's kind of exciting, and I only realize that in retrospect. When you're going through it, you don't analyze it. You just want to be with that kid who happens to be an Indian from New Mexico, or that woman, young woman who is from Chicago. It's elusive while you're there. It's only in retrospect that I I realize the impact of the encampment. Is that a, do I get an A+ on that answer? Yes. Not too many questions because they have refreshments after.
Hi, my name is Dr. Rothenberg and I'm the director of the...
Yes, we had a little talk before. And
yeah. So a couple of things next to children and teenagers with their incarcerated parents. I will find my voice. So telelisting connects children and teenagers with their incarcerated parents through telepresence. We have a telepresence room here, and then mom or dad beams in from Rikers Island. And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit, I'm really curious about your insights about the importance of maintaining connection
yes.
while you're incarcerated.
Well, what I told you but when you introduced yourself before, in the early days of Fortune, after that David Susskind show, one of the letters I got was from a woman who said, Barbara, her name was Barbara Allen, and she said, I'm doing my time on the outside. She was a school teacher from Long Island, didn't know anything about the criminal justice system until her husband killed his father, and she was dealing with two children, trials, court, visiting somebody you love, talking to them through mesh wire, and she found her voice, and she started a group with other, she was meeting other women and children in the visiting room and organized because of their outrage at the way they were being treated as visitors. She said at the beginning she wouldn't let her kids visit their father when he was at Greenhaven because they had meshed wire and she didn't want her children to see, to talk to their father through a wire. And her protest led to the removal of that wire. But she has continued over the years with a program that deals with the relatives, and I'm sad to say it's almost always the women in the families. It's the mothers and the wives and the girlfriends. Like when you go to a men's prison on a visiting day, it's almost all women visiting. And when you go to a woman's prison, it's almost all women visiting. But she's involved with the children. She's done classes with, they have programs for the kids. So that they, it's very tough for children whose fathers are away. They, you know, they had to deal with lying and making up stories and being embarrassed and being picked on at school.